What is inference analysis and why do we need it for vehicle load optimization? An inference shape shows us how a load effect varies depending on where a load is placed on a structure. It can therefore be used to identify the most onerous position to put, for example, a vehicle on that structure. It's therefore very important for doing traffic load optimization to design codes and is hence used by the LUSAS vehicle load optimizer. So here, for example, is a very simple inference line. This is the inference for bending at point 4. This tells us that if we put a vehicle with loads P1, P2, P3 and P4 in this position, the effect it will have on the bending moment at point 4 is P1 times 0.153 plus P2 times 0.206 plus P3 times 0.084 plus P4 times 0.051. But how did we determine this inference line in the first place? There are two main methods for this, the reciprocal theorem and a direct method. In the reciprocal theorem, at the point of interest, you break the mesh and apply a deformation that mimics the effect you're looking for. So for bending, that means applying a rotation to both of the broken ends of the mesh. The deformed mesh from that analysis then gives us the inference shape. The second method is a direct method, where what we do is take a unit load and apply it to each position on the structure in turn, recording the effect that each placement has on the location we're interested in. So if we apply a load at point 0, we get 0 bending moment at point 4, so we write down 0. If we apply a load at point 1, we get a bending moment of 0.05 at point 4, so we write that down. We continue this through placing the load in other positions, and using that we can draw out the whole of the inference shape. In LUSAS we can do not just inference lines but inference surfaces, by looking at how the load effect varies as we move the load not just longitudinally but transversely also. This is important where multiple lane layouts are possible. For example, this carriageway to the American AASHTO code fits 3 lanes and a remaining unloaded area, shown in red. Using our inference surface, we can determine the most onerous place to position the lanes, and when allowed by the code, the most onerous position within those lanes to position the vehicles. We also take account of varying length of axles where required and can omit axles which reduce the load effect we're looking for, again only when specified by the design code. I'm going to create an inference surface on this structure, which is a beam and slab bridge, where the webs of the beams and the deck slab are modelled as shell elements, shown in green, while the flanges, stiffeners and cross bracing are all modelled as beam elements, shown here in pink. Here we can see that same structure on plan. The first thing I'm going to do on this structure is to find some beam slices. This is where we specify which elements define a compound beam. LUSAS can then slice through the elements and use the stresses to determine a total bending moment, axial force and shear force on the compound beam. I'm going to do this for girder 1. If we go to the group tabs and select girder 1, and we can then see which objects are part of this girder definition. If I select the lines for the top flange, we'll use that to define the centre line of the compound beam. So I go to utilities, slice resultants, and I'm going to put one slice at the beginning and use this option to create a slice at the start and end of every individual line making up that path. I'm going to specify that it can only pick up elements that are part of this girder 1 group. I'll give it a name, girder 1. And we can now see, if we zoom in, a little red box to find the extents of the slice at the slice location. And if we turn on the bending moment diagram for the beam shell slice MY, we can see the bending moment diagram under permanent load. Next, I'm going to define inference through attribute inference direct method. New in version 19, we can now select beam shell slice resultants, and I'm going to choose for MY. I can then right click and assign to girder 1 in a new direct method inference analysis. I can then solve the inference analysis in order to find the inference shapes. I'm going to set active the inference at, say, 16 meters along, and then turn on the contours layer in order to see the inference shape. So what this shows us is that anything from this light orange towards the blue is giving us a negative effect, i.e. sagging. So a load placed in most locations on this left-hand span of this three-span bridge is going to cause sagging effect. Anything placed in the second span is going to cause a hogging effect. Anything placed in the third span is going to create a sagging effect. Unsurprisingly, the most onerous place longitudinally within that span is directly over the point that we're interested in at 16 feet. and transversely the most onerous place is the far side of the structure, where all the load will be picked up by girder 1 rather than shared with girder 2. By looking at other influences, we can see how as we move along the structure, the influence shape changes. Here we can see an influence over the pier, where unsurprisingly loading both the adjacent spans gives us a hogging moment. We can then use these influences to generate our live load patterns. To do that, we need to select the curb lines that define the edges of our carriageway, then go to Bridge Vehicle Load Optimization. For this example, I'm going to use ASHTO, and I'm going to generate it without any factors being applied, and just for the notional design load. Choose which influences to optimize for. I'm going to go for all of them, but I'm only going to go for negative, i.e. looking at the sagging effect for this example. Click Define Carriageways to let LUSAS know that the lines I've selected define the curbs, and choose to create loading patterns. So if we look here, we can see that the biggest bending moment was 1,278 kilopound feet, and it was found at 32 or 33 feet along from the start of the girder. If we then look at the loading pattern that's been created, we'll turn off the geometry layer to make it a bit clearer. And what we can see are the red dots are showing where the wheels of vehicle loads are being applied, and the purple dots are representing the uniformly distributed lane load. We can see that two lanes have been loaded within span 1, and the two lanes have both been moved as far to the top of the bridge as we're looking at it as possible. We can also see that the uniformly distributed lane load continues in span 3. We can also see that within span 1, the vehicles are staggered slightly, as LUSAS have found that this creates the largest possible sagging moment.